Council meeting, Monday, May 12th. If we could have a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And we now have an opportunity to do a few presentations, and I'm going to start everything off.
The roll call first.
Oh, that was left off too, wasn't it? No, it wasn't there.
No, it wasn't.
Exactly. Sure we're all here.
Jack, I'm stepping on your toes. Would you call the roll call, please?
Chairman Harvard.
Present.
Councilor Berry.
Here.
Councilor Carson.
Here.
Councilor Fritz.
Here.
Councilor Lynch.
Here.
Councilor McGinty.
Here.
Councilor Swift-Kiata.
Here.
And
we're both here.
Oh, I'm sorry. Manager McGovern.
And the town clerk is here as well. Our student reps appear to be missing at the moment. In my haste to do something rather pleasant, I was rushing the program. Good point. At this point, I have the pleasure of asking our former town clerk and new assistant town manager if she would come up here. Deborah, everybody probably knows Deborah O'Leary, but Deborah Lane. How many years are you town clerk? It probably says right in here, doesn't it? And I get the wrong plaque.
I can't throw my voice that far.
Well, I guess this meeting's starting off on late, don't it? You're real good, yeah. Whereas Deborah M. Lane was appointed the town clerk of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, in 1986, and whereas she immediately faced the difficult task of replacing the legendary town clerk, Natalie B. Libby, who had served ably the town for 18 years as clerk, and whereas Deborah M. Lane flawlessly conducted each and every local, state, and national election, including presidential elections in 1988, 92, 96, and 2000, and whereas Deborah tremendously improved the record-keeping of official records, including vital records and financial records of the community, and whereas Deborah Lane served as president of the Maine Town and City Clerks Association and the New England Clerks Association and assisted in hosting conventions for these organizations, and whereas she represented clerks in helping to shepherd important election reform issues through the state government, including a statewide voter registration system, and whereas Deborah has been recognized as a certified municipal clerk by the International Institute of Municipal Clerks and as a town clerk of the year by the Maine City and Town Clerks Association, and whereas Deborah Lane has served as a staff resource for the trustees of Riverside Cemetery and helped to oversee major expansion of the cemetery and the codification of rules of the cemetery, and whereas Deborah M. Lane has served as the clerk of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, keeping accurate and complete council minutes for over 300 meetings, and whereas she has simultaneously served as administrative assistant to the town manager, as town office manager, as acting town manager in the absence of the manager, as the de facto tax collector, as the administrator of the town's telecommunications system, and has worked countless hours professionally to fulfill all of her responsibilities, and whereas Deborah M. Lane has resigned as Cape Elizabeth Town Clerk to accept a new appointment as Assistant Town Manager of Cape Elizabeth, now, therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby thank Deborah M. Lane for all that she has accomplished as Cape Elizabeth Town Clerk since 1986, and we wish her equal success as she assumes her new responsibilities as the Assistant Manager. Signed, sealed, and dated this 12th day of June in the year 2003, anno domini, in Cape Elizabeth, Maine, by the members of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Congratulations, Deborah.
Thank you, sir.
One more fact for Debbie to hang on her wall. She has plenty of them over her career. And more to come, I'm sure. Thank you very much. The next one you snatch together, you can go down. Do one at a time, or you want to both go down?
That's okay, we'll go up here and see.
Here you go.
I'm very pleased to present this plaque in honor of Henry Barry, so I'd like Henry to come down here. Town of Cape Elizabeth, Cape Elizabeth Town Council resolution in honor of Henry N. Barry III. Whereas Henry N. Barry was first elected to the Cape Elizabeth Town Council 35 years ago, to the first ever town council upon the adoption of the council manager form of government. And whereas, during his first term of office, he cast key votes which led to the construction of the Cape Elizabeth High School. And whereas Henry Barry cast the deciding vote, which in 1968 defeated a proposal from the Cape Elizabeth Urban Renewal Authority to turn Fort Williams into an office and residential park. And whereas Henry Barry ably served as a district attorney for Cumberland County and has represented the town of Cape Elizabeth on the County Budget Advisory Committee. And whereas Henry Barry was elected in 1997 and 2000, to two additional terms as member of the town council, and whereas he supported the purchase of the Gulf Crest property in order to preserve open space, create new ball fields, and provide for public works space needs, and whereas Henry Barry worked to implement solutions to critical space needs in the police and fire department, and whereas Henry Barry has watched after the needs of seniors and youth alike in advocating for a new community center, the renovation of the Richards Pool, the development of a fitness center, funds for new playgrounds, and other programs to assist seniors and youth, and even donated his entire council pay for 2 years to support new playgrounds. And whereas Henry Barry has steadfastly sought to protect the scenic beauty of Cape Elizabeth through support of the acquisition of the Robinson Woods, through his encouragement of the development of a master plan for Gulf Crest property, by voting for protection for the town farm property, and through his ever watchful eye over any development in his beloved Two Lights neighborhood, and has devoted many hours to quietly helping those most in need in Cape Elizabeth, through his review of applications and through special assistance he has given as a member of the Grants Committee of the Thomas Jordan Trust. And whereas Henry Barry will be completing a total of 9 years of service on the Cape Elizabeth Town Council on June 9, 2003. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and Town Council assembled does hereby thank Henry Barry III for his vision, his untiring dedication to his community, and his love for Cape Elizabeth and its citizens. And we wish him well as he retires as a member of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Sealed and dated the 12th day of May, the year 2003.
You may be seated. Thank you very much. I'm just overwhelmed. And I thank the citizens of Cape Elizabeth for staying with me through this entire thing you've just heard. And the very best wishes to the new councilors who are coming in to carry on the business of the town. I wish them well. They have a lot of issues to wrestle with. And Godspeed, darling.
Come down, please.
Gee, right door.
I'd like to read this resolution. Town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, Cape Elizabeth Town Council resolution in honor of Penelope P. Carson. Whereas Penelope P. Carson was first elected to the Cape Elizabeth Town Council in 1979 and served until 1988. And whereas she was re-elected to the town council in 1998 and again in 2000,
And whereas Penny Carson has always been passionate in her beliefs and eloquent in defense of her position, and whereas Penny chaired the committee which led to the preservation of the Pond Cove School Annex and its eventual transition into the Thomas Memorial Library, and whereas the Goddard Mansion would have been a pile of rubble without Penny's timely intervention in defeating a proposal for its immediate demolition, and whereas she supported the purchase of the Gulfcrest property in order to preserve open space, create new ball fields, and provide for public works space needs, and whereas Penny Carson worked to implement solutions to critical space needs in the police and fire departments, and whereas she has watched after the needs of seniors and youth alike in advocating for a new community center, the renovation of the Richards Pool, the development of a fitness center, funds for new playgrounds and other programs to assist seniors and youth, and whereas Penny Carson has steadfastly sought to protect the scenic beauty of Cape Elizabeth through support of the acquisition of the Robinson Woods, through her encouragement of the development of a master plan for the Gulfcrest property, by voting for protection for the town farm property, through her participation in helping to create the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation, and in her prior service as a board member of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and whereas she served as president of the Greater Portland Council of Governments, as a board member of the Waynesfleet School, as a Little League coach, that's one I didn't know, and on the Portland City Manager's Business Advisory Council, and whereas Penny Carson will be completing a total of 14 years of service on the Cape Elizabeth Town Council on June 9, 2003. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby thank Penelope P. Carson for her vision, her untiring dedication to Cape Elizabeth and to all of Greater Portland, and we wish her well as she retires as a member of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Signed, sealed, and dated this 12th day of May in the year 2003 in Cape Elizabeth, Maine, by her respectful and admiring friends who have been privileged to serve with her on the Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Thank you very much, and I do have some comments that I might make after the end of our town council meeting, so I won't take the time tonight, but thank you very much. It has certainly been an honor.
While they're taking their seats, I'd like to thank the town manager, who obviously put a lot of time and effort in compiling those commendations for us. Thank you, Mike.
I'd like to ask a question of Councillor Carson. When are we going to get the Goddard Mansion up and running?
Restaurant?
No, not a restaurant.
B&B?
Not a restaurant. It's probably been a furniture store. It's not going to be a restaurant yet.
B&B was one of our better ones. But, you know, I'd get a group to lay down in front of that tractor.
It's kind of an inside joke, sorry.
And do any of our counselors this evening have any reports or correspondence that they would like to share with us? No one this evening.
All right.
The town clerk says she would like to.
I just have a statement saying there will be a special referendum election on Tuesday, June 10th, 2003, and that we are doing absentee ballots in the office as we speak.
What is that?
Special referendums from the state, the bond issue. One question.
It's a $60 million bond issue to stimulate economic growth and job creation through investments in research and development, municipal infrastructure and facilities, the Maine Farms for the Future program, and affordable housing.
Thank you.
It's in front of us.
Another unfunded mandate from the state. How much is that going to cost us? Any idea? Approximately?
$1,000.
All right. And the town manager, do you have anything you'd like to share?
Yes, thanks, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of things. First of all, We did a municipal election a little less than a week ago, and I do want to thank the new town clerk for her conduct of that election. You know, it's always a challenge to figure out everything that needs to be done before an election. I think it was done flawlessly, and I want to thank Jackie for her excellent work with that election, as well as Henry Adams, who is our election warden, and all the different workers and everyone else who participated in the election, including the voters. Secondly, I wanted to make mention of Harry Proudman, who was our cable TV coordinator. He worked with the football boosters a couple weeks ago, along with two young Joshua young men, I think they're senior, Joshua, I'll get the pronunciation right, who were seniors at Cape Elizabeth High School, and worked with the football boosters and putting an auction on CETV. And I think it's interesting. Harry, just about a week before that, we had a little birthday party for him upstairs where he celebrated his 85th birthday. And to think that when I look at Henry Adams, who is an octogenarian, and I look at Harry Proudman, who's 85, to have, you know, two major things done in essentially a week's period by employees who are over the age of 80, I think is quite significant and noteworthy in both of them and the professional job they did in assisting with each thing. Would like to mention that the state is continuing progress on Route 77. They put the initial inch of paving down last fall. They're going to be putting the final pavement on sometime in the next 2 weeks, and that's what you see all the prep work going on there for. We don't yet know the exact date. We'll try to get out on a web page. I know there were concerns last year that the notices that some people didn't know last fall when it was about to be paved, but there will be folks held up a little bit from that. The Memorial Day parade is coming up at 9 a.m. on Memorial Day from Fowler Road to the Memorial area. I want to thank Jim Cox, who's conducting that this year, for all of his efforts in helping to put that together. And lastly, I would like to give you a brief update on how the revaluation process is coming along. All the notices have now gone out. All the information is available on the webpage as well. I want to thank Matt Sturgis and Wendy Derswick for getting this really complete information on the webpage and getting the notices out. Everyone in the staff upstairs for all of the work they've done on the revaluation. The phone calls have been extremely busy. The appointments are booked right through May 21st, I believe, as of this afternoon. And Matt has had, I think he had 25 meetings today with citizens with questions about their assessments, and he's been having slightly less than that all of last week. And he said, with out of all the citizens who've come in, who's probably now over 100, there was really only one that wasn't real pleasant and came in a good frame of mind. And I appreciate everyone's understanding of that process and the respect that they've been showing for the assessor when they come in and have questions. And if anyone does have questions on their new assessment, I'd encourage them to look at the webpage. There's a link at the very top for new assessments. And also, if they'd like to meet with Matt Sturgis, our assessor, also do encourage them to make a call between now and May 23rd. The appointments are going to go beyond May 23rd, but you should call prior to May 23rd for an appointment. But overall, the process seems to be going really well, and while I know some people are concerned with the increases in their assessments, they can be ensured if they meet with the assessor, they'll have a very fair hearing, and I think he'll be helpful in helping them to understand the evaluation or in having Matt understand where there might be an error in the assessment as well. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Next item on the agenda is the opportunity for citizens to discuss items that are not on our agenda. And we hold one early in the meeting and one at the very end of the meeting. If there is anyone who would like you to address the council on an issue that's not on the agenda, you're welcome to step forward at this time. Please give us your name and your address. Would you mind turning that around facing us, too. Thank you. I forgot to turn that back.
My name is Christopher Lynch, and I live on Shore Road. And I just want to Mike's point, is I did meet with Matt on the assessments and found out from Matt that obviously there are a number of homes in town that basically their assessments either stayed the same, not assessments, but that their tax bills actually stayed the same, and many, many, many homes were lowered. And my background is on the financing side. I worked 16 years on Wall Street and have an expertise in bond financing. And rates hit a record low for municipal debt as well as for public debt in the last week or so. And so I would encourage the councilors to take advantage of that opportunity, where we've had a number of homes in town that have actually seen a lower tax bill, or will see a lower tax bill this year than they did last year. And many that didn't change, and record low interest rates out there in this environment, it's a great opportunity to fix some of the other things that may be broken or not working quite as well in town, that it's really a perfect backdrop to do some financing and actually get things fixed. So I'd encourage you to consider that and take advantage of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else that would like to speak to items that are not on the agenda, please? Seeing none? Okay. The minutes, have a motion, please, for the minutes of number 13, 0203, held April 14, 2003, and number 14, 0203, held April 28, 2003, and continued to the April 30, 2003 meeting. Is there someone willing to make a motion to accept those, please?
Second.
Any discussion, corrections, additions? Seeing none, all in favor of accepting the minutes? Thank you, Jackie. And it's 7-0. Item number 114-0203 is the Municipal School Community Services and County Budgets. And I'm going to turn all of our budget items over to our Finance Chair, Mary Ann Lynch. So, Mary Ann, if you would like to give us an explanation and move us forward on this.
Before I do any motions, I'd just like to explain to the Council and the public, at this point in time, when I do make a motion, I would intend to move item 114-0203 separately from all of the other budget items. Okay? Now. Just a little introduction. The Finance Committee of the Town Council has met 8 times since the first of the year with the town manager, with department heads, the school board, and the school department in preparation of the fiscal year 2004 budget. The Finance Committee is pleased to report a budget that is both fiscally sound and responsive to the needs of the community. The total budget, town, school, county, and community services, for fiscal year 04 is $24.33 million for a net tax increase of 2.4%. The town budget is $7.3 million, and by town I mean municipal, for a 2.01% tax increase. The school board and the school department deserve special recognition for proposing a budget that results in a minimal tax increase. This is no small effort on their part, considering the numerous unfunded mandates from Washington and Augusta. I recently heard the legislation entitled No Child Left Behind, referred to as No Administrator Left Behind. So we really do appreciate the efforts of the school board and the school department. The school budget is $15.3 million and results in a 2.26 tax increase. So we want to thank them for their efforts in developing a budget that is fiscally sound and, more importantly, educationally sound. The council adopted the school budget without change. I should note that our share of the county budget is up 6.7%, a figure over which the town has no control. I would encourage citizens in the coming year to follow the county charter change process and hopefully the towns and residential taxpayers can have a little more control over that process. We also want to thank the department heads and town employees for their contributions to the budget process. Given the increase in employee benefit costs and fuel, it has been a challenge to municipal employees to continue to provide the residents of Cape Elizabeth with the public safety, public works, and community services that they have come to expect. We'd also like to single out the town manager for special thanks for the time and effort that he puts in the preparation of this budget. We appreciate your knowledge, your counsel, and your hard work. And finally, to thank the many people who volunteer their time in this community in so many different capacities. I hesitate to list them all for fear of omitting some, but from the fire and the rescue, to the gift shop at Fort Williams, to the people who work to maintain our large trail system, and to the volunteers in our schools, we recognize that Cape Elizabeth reaps the benefits of so many dedicated and generous volunteers. So as we present this budget, we want to say thank you to all of you who have given so much to the town and the community. And at this time, I would like to move item 114-02-03. In particular, I move adoption of the general fund budget for fiscal year 2004 with gross expenditures of $24,330,000 and gross revenues of $6,641,724, and with the amount of $17,688,276 to be raised from taxation, and further move to fix Tuesday, October 7th, 2003, and Tuesday, October 6th, 2004, as the dates upon which each of which one half of such tax is due and payable, and as more fully set forth in the printed agenda.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded.
April 6th, not
April. I'm sorry, did I?
April 6th.
Just a typo. You don't need to amend.
Yeah, just
verbal typo.
While we're discussing typos, just before you get to item number 115, that paragraph on the third page, the debt service.
Yes.
That should read 934,184 in each case, rather than 180.
Instead
doesn't affect
of 180,
the,
okay.
The bottom line at all, but it should read 184.
All right. Great. Do we have any discussion? Councilor McGinty.
You know, I don't know who set up this process, but obviously, you know, we have to vote for each of the, you know, the school, the municipal, the county, all at once. And we don't get to separate out and say, I support the school budget and I don't support the municipal budget. We get the vote, we have one vote. And I do support the school budget. I don't support the county budget. I don't support the municipal budget. I do support the community services budget. I think that when we had a chance, when we found a $75,000 hole in our budget, the municipal budget, rather than make hard choices, we decided to raise taxes. And I think we should have made the hard choices.
We didn't do it.
No, we didn't.
We decided to sell property.
We decided to sell property.
Property, well.
Property.
We
decided to sell unspecified property. We haven't sold anything.
There you go.
Okay?
Right.
And I made that argument at the time. We haven't sold. We haven't filled that hole. We said, we will deal with this later with unspecified property, which, you know, I'm not a very good politician. Everybody knows I'm not a very good politician, but I think that's poor policy to do that. And I said that at the time. Everybody shake your head, please. I said that at the time. Yes, I said it was bad policy to say somehow we're going to fill this hole with unspecified property sale. And so, as usual, I will not be supporting this budget. I do support the school budget. I want everybody to know. I see Elaine and Jen and Bree, and if I'm missing anybody, I'm sorry. I don't see everybody here, but they did. Heck of a job. We asked them to hold down their budget. They did it, and we didn't. And so I'll be voting against this.
Any further comments?
Public hearing.
This is a public hearing, isn't it? And before we open the public hearing, do you want to?
Pardon me?
I am going to open up a public hearing, so.
Okay. I thought we were in discussion.
Yeah, we. I jumped ahead of it on that one, too.
Well,
it's my last meeting, too.
I only have one short comment, which was Councilor McGinty is correct, as he as he amended his argument there, that we didn't vote to raise taxes, we voted to sell property. That is correct. But as far as holding us not holding taxes down, I think we did hold the tax rate down, as you can see, to 2.01%. So I think that characterization I would not agree with.
Thank you. At this time, I would open the budget, the school and the municipal, up to anyone that would like to speak from the public. If you please come up to the podium
and all those other budgets.
And you want to do the other ones as well?
Yeah, I'll just
we'll do them all. Anything that's on the agenda, and you have copies there, any of the budgets that are on that, we could take public comment at this point. So anyone?
Through number 121.
Through number 121 on your agendas that you have. Is there anyone wishing to speak to the budget?
Any resident?
Nope. All right. Public session is closed and public comment. We now can go to further council discussion if anyone would like. Councillor?
I would just make one comment in contrast to the numerous phone calls that and emails that I had last year on the budget. I've had none this year, which suggests to me that the public is happy with, I mean, it's hard to read something out of silence, but I'm assuming that the public is satisfied with the budget as proposed.
Okay.
Councilor McGinty.
I would like to commend the finance chair, as I told her privately on the phone a couple days ago, I think. Did a great job, and I think that's not the issue. It's never the issue with me. It's that I think we're always spending too much money, and I commend the Councilor Lynch. She did a great job as council chair, and I told her that, as I said privately, I say it publicly now. She did a great job, as the school board did. It's great. I was also asked for a roll call vote on this.
Councilor Barry, you look like you wanted to say something.
Well, I just am disappointed that the county government has gone up 6.74%. Both John and I have served on that advisory board, which is, in a sense, meaningless because they don't have a vote. And I hope that in this charter revision that the county will have a better democratic representation than having two out of three councilors commissioners make a decision for a $25 million budget. I think that is too much clout in one place, and I think there should be better representation throughout the county to decide how our money is going to be spent, because under the present system, they send a bill, and by statute, we have to send the money back. And it's gone up from $763,000 last year for Cape Elizabeth's share alone to $814,000 this year. And both John and I did not approve that much of an expenditure, and we were outvoted. But I still think we were right.
Thank you. Karen?
I don't want to leave the others out. I mean, the school has done a magnificent job in putting this together. I agree with John on that. And as far as the municipal side of the town government, town budget, I'm trying to say, I congratulate our manager, Mike McGovern, for cutting this right down to the bare things. That we, at the last minute, had a $75,000 bomb thrust on us because of an auditor's error, and we had to deal with that through nobody's fault on the council, nobody's fault in the management. The auditors admitted that they just found this figure that had to be accounted for. And so I think selling unidentified pieces of property is not a good idea. And I hope they don't descend upon the town hall or sell the high school. But there are slivers of, it's a possible thing under this budget, under this vote, that would be possible. It's not going to happen, but there are a bunch of slivers of land around town that were contemplated for possible sale to various parties. And some of those should be identified and listed, and perhaps that could raise some revenue for the town to make it at least part of that $75,000 that came through. Other than that, I would vote for the budget. I was going to vote. I wish we could vote in parts for the budget, because I could support the school, and I appreciate the manager's good work on this side, on the municipal side of the budget. But I disagree with the county, and I just think it's too bad that all has to be lumped in together. That's all.
Thank you. Councilor Fritz.
Well, I just want to echo some of the other things that have been said. I particularly think the school board did a good job coming in reasonably close to the increase that the town council was asking them to come to, and their budget continues to provide the excellent education that we expect in Cape Elizabeth. I appreciate a couple of the creative things they did with sharing, like the school psychologist with Cumberland, doing creative things in the Pond Cove School with the staff, the same as the town manager has done, looking at staff and consolidating jobs and in the town budget. And I think this budget continues to provide the citizens with great service in our municipality. I think we were lucky that we didn't have more of a cut from the state in the school funding. I think for the next year, we've got to begin now looking at ways that we can be creative for next year, because we are going to be cut from the state, and I think we've done a lot of bare bones things within our community. We've got to look outside and doing some things together with neighboring communities, and we need to start talking about that now. But I will be supporting the budget.
Thank you. No further comments from that side? I likewise will be voting for the budget. I am concerned that both the municipal and the school budgets are not as high as they should be, quite frankly. We've lost a lot of money. A lot of the needs that the town and the schools have are not being addressed, and these items have not gone away. They are there, hanging out for us to have to deal with in years to come. The roads continue to get bad. The schools have identified a number of issues that they've postponed, and those are still there, but we know it's a tough economic time, and everybody has bit the bullet this year and done the best that they can, and I appreciate everybody's efforts on that, and all I can say is I wish there were more money for all of us, and I wish the state and the feds were doing more of their share so that we did not find ourselves in this position year in and year out. So with that, thank you, everybody, and I will also vote for it. So I would call the question at this point. All in favor of... John Wonderoco. Jack, you're up.
Councilor Berry.
Yes.
Councilor Carson.
Yes.
Councilor Fritz.
Yes.
Councilor Lynch.
Yes.
Councilor McGinty.
No.
Councilor Swift-Gayata.
Yes.
And Chairman Roberts.
Yes.
Six yes and one no.
Correct. And so, Councilor Lynch, I'll move back to you then for items 115 through, I believe it was 121.
I move adoption of items 115 through 121 as more fully set out in our agenda.
Second.
And we have a motion and a second. Any discussion from council?
Could we just, I'm sorry, I was just going to state for the record and for the public at home watching that what we are moving is adoption of the sewer fund budget, the Riverside Cemetery fund budget, the Museum at Portland Headlight fund budget, the Spurwink Church fund budget, Fort Williams Park Capital fund budget, the Thomas Jordan Trust fund budget, and the Rescue fund budget.
Thank you. All in favor? And you can show that can be unanimous. Item number 122-0203, Appointments Committee Report. And I would move to the Appointments Chair, Councilor Carson.
Thank you very much. The Appointments Committee has met a few times this past several weeks, and again, we have three openings on boards and commissions that are unexpired terms for existing members. Our usual term starts in January. But as usual, we had a wonderful group of citizens who volunteered for a variety of positions. The only unfortunate thing is that we only had three places to put for 20 people. So we hope very much that they will keep their names in the hopper and reapply when there were likely to be some more openings as terms actually expire in the fall for the beginning term in January. But tonight we are recommending the following. For Fort Williams Advisory Committee, Ellen Netto. For the Arts Commission, Joan Frustaci. And for Conservation Commission, Carol Haas. We unanimously appointed these people. And I ask for your... I'm making that as a motion.
That is a motion. All right. And we have a second. All right. Did you? Any discussion from council? Seeing none. All in favor? And that is unanimous as well. Item number 123-0203, draft vote authorizing addition to the Pond Cove School. This item has been put on the agenda tonight. Basically, back in March, we had discussed perhaps putting it on in July. We received all of the information that we needed. I sat down with the chair of the school board and asked Marie Prager if she had a problem with my putting this on the agenda in May. We have been working on this for 2 years, intensely this year, and I wanted to get all of these issues addressed and off the plate during my year as chair, and this would be my last meeting. I saw no reason to have it hanging on later. I know there have been some negative comments about it, and there was no ulterior motive other than get the issue resolved. I hope people understand that and appreciate where I'm coming from. Have received a lot of positive comments from a number of people, and as well as a lot of comments that I hate to see in this town, but that's another issue. Before we move to further motion, I know Mary Townsend had asked if she would be allowed to speak. The public hearing was back in March. Mary, if you'd like to take a second, you're welcome to.
Thanks for the opportunity to give one more push. My name's Mary Townsend, and I live at 5 Pearl Street, and I thank you for the opportunity to address the council tonight on the issue of the school building project. You know, a lot
just
of
put
you
your speaker down so the audience can
is
hear
that
you.
Better?
No, the audience, the TV audience can
okay.
hear you.
I know a lot of you have spent a lot of hours examining the current recommendations, and I appreciate your time and effort. I think we all want to do what's best for the schools and for the children of this town who represent about a third of the population. I agree with a lot of the counselors who have said that first-rate teachers are the key to a good education and not bricks and mortar. But it seems myopic to me to assume that the conditions of public school buildings do not affect the quality of a student's educational experience or a school system's ability to attract and retain the high-quality teachers. At first glance, I fear that your decision to put school building issues to a fall referendum may put our system at risk. Therefore, I'd like to understand why your recommendations differ from that of the school board and from the appointed school building committee who spent 3 years examining this issue in great depth. Do you feel that you have more accurate information that leads you to a different vision for our schools? As this council well knows, the absence of information breeds suspicion and ill will, as you already pointed out, Jack. And so in a good faith effort, could you tell us what you've learned? You've said that population projections will be integral in your decision tonight, but these projections appear to have been inaccurate year after year. Next year, the projections are 20% lower than the actual enrollment numbers for kindergarten and about the same for first grade. While I realize estimations are tricky at best, years of inaccuracies make me distrustful of whatever model that we've chosen. Does this council have a vision for where we'll house the kindergartners who have been in the high school for the last 10 years? 10 years. how many more years until we determine that we have a long-term problem on our hands that that deserves a long-term solution? I fear that by delaying the Pond Cove addition, we are delaying the inevitable at a much higher cost to the taxpayer. We may now be committed to portables at a cost of about $100,000 for the first year. If the referendum passes in November, that money's been wasted. I've also heard rumbling about shifting elementary students into middle school to make space. As a community, I'm wondering, are we prepared to abandon our commitment to the K-4 education and move our fourth graders, who are 9 and 10-year-olds, into the middle school? Or will we just shuffle students year to year wherever we can find an open classroom because we don't want to make a commitment to a permanent public building? If so, let's be clear about it. And let's be clear about how long we expect to delay. I say this not to confront or to place blame, but to point out where there's no vision, there's no commitment to the future. As a town, we've made a conscious effort to protect open space and parkland. The town had a vision, and we all benefited. And we all benefit from strong schools, because they're what entice young families to live here and keep our property values high. So I ask you to please make sure that we as a community have as much vision for the protection of our schools as we do for the wetlands. Our children are our greatest natural resource, and they need ample space and quality conditions, and those needs, I think, have been delayed long enough. I look forward to hearing this council's explanation for its current recommendation and what its vision is for the future of our schools. And again, I thank you for the opportunity to speak to you, and I thank you for your service.
Thank you, Mary. I understand that Elaine did want to also speak to the council. Marie indicated that, no, you're all set? All right, fine, good, all right. Then, Marianne, did you want a question?
Is there anyone else that wants to speak?
No one else addressed me, called me about it.
Okay.
Okay. I guess there is another gentleman.
Hi, my name is Kevin Google. I live at 12 Wombeck Road. And I also appreciate the opportunity to address the council tonight on the topic of the Pond Cove addition. And I'd like to say, I just think as we probe more deeply into this decision, that we need to understand better the council's priorities and process when it approves $6.8 million in bonds for the public works garage, police station, fire station construction with little or no debate, and yet sees no need to approve the $1.5 million bond for the addition to Pond Cove. I wonder where the scrutiny and questioning of the need for public works and safety projects that the Pond Cove addition now faces. Why did the council so quickly believe in the need for the $6.8 million in bonds for these purposes and now can't accept the position of the school board, whom we elected, when it says that the Pond Cove school needs the space to appropriately teach the elementary population? The $6.8 million public works and public safety projects are 4 times as expensive as the Pond Cove addition, and yet they received a quick and unanimous approval, while the addition project has faced unusual scrutiny and misgivings. This just seems inconsistent to me. And according to the town hall, the addition will cost $16 a year for a $200,000 home, whereas the $6.8 million public works and safety projects cost $72 a year for the same home. When I look at this comparison, I'm compelled to ask, why is the process different this time? Are we saying that the needs of our schools are somehow not as important as updating our public works garage? On a different note, it seems that you've put a lot of weight on the enrollment forecast. I ask that you please do so carefully. I believe that the previous forecasts for our schools have underestimated enrollment as recently as for this year's kindergarten, as Mary pointed out. This should come as no surprise. I think the development which Southern Maine is experiencing has caught most communities by surprise. Southern Maine continues to be under remarkable pressure to grow. Development has occurred in unexpected levels in all communities, and this is not going to change. With each year, new houses, be it 25 or 30, take your pick, are built in Cape Elizabeth. Each year, therefore, our population grows. This is irreversible, it's impactful, and we're ignoring the facts if we think these new houses won't have an effect on our services. If this project is not approved, portables will be paid for, and we continue to grow as we have been, then in several years' time, we'll be looking at building this addition again, but at a higher cost to the taxpayer, with additional costs at the Port of Police. This is fiscally unsound planning. Finally, let's be very clear about why, as a town, we enjoy such high home values. Most houses in Cape aren't on the water, yet demand for a house in Cape Elizabeth remains reliably strong. Most of that can be credited to the excellent reputation of schools. So let's not be miserly about investment into our schools and thus our homes. The old saying, penny wise and pound foolish, is certainly appropriate for this decision you're about to make. I thank you very much for your time in listening, and I urge you to make the right decision. I urge you to vote in favor of the pond prohibition. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak before the council?
Hi, Christopher Lynch, Shore Road. I spoke about an off-agenda item. With respect to the agenda item is, I actually found out that item 123-0203 was actually on the agenda of tonight. I found out yesterday. So, Chairman Roberts, I was not one of the people who was critical because I didn't actually know it was coming. But I just for clarification is, I did sit through the March 12th meeting, and it was not, you know, perhaps discussed putting it on in July. It was a 7-0 unanimous vote moved by Councilor Swift Kayada and Councilor Barry, which ordered Cape Elizabeth Town Council to defer a decision on the kindergarten addition until July 14th, 2003 council meeting. So it was one, just for clarity's sake, is I don't understand the workings of Town Council and how we go from a unanimous 7-0 vote by the councilors and then have it come up 60 days later when there wasn't enough information then to merit putting it, you know, voting for it to have it in this meeting in the first place. So I for one, I don't understand it. I'm not favorable for it. I just wanted that on record. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Maybe that needs to be explained. That the reason we're here tonight is that the school board asked us to be here tonight. In a letter, they asked us to put it on tonight. And I believe that the July date was pretty much arbitrary. We just said, we'll put it off, and we picked July. It could have been August, it could have been June. You just kind of picked July.
It was a
reason.
I need, no.
Yeah, but no. it was just a...
No. It was my decision, after speaking with Marie, I was planning on putting on two items, one to refer to referendum and one to for the Pond Cove, and one to put the high school on for referendum. Marie came back and asked that we put a vote for the kindergarten as well, just to up or down on the kindergarten this evening. That was how that came down to play. So the school board asked that we vote on the kindergarten if I was putting the other two items on and just do that one. Marie, is that correct? You come to that. Thank you. Yes, thank you. And again, I've stated previously, once we got the building reports, which we did not have back in that other meeting, I felt there was no reason to delay it till the middle of summer when half the people are out of town and there's no one here. This gives us a lot. Assuming it is to go to referendum, it gives the school board a lot more time to educate the public before the November referendum to get it taken care of. That was my concern, that everybody would have plenty of time. I had even considered that on the high school renovation issue, that it would give us time to put together a small committee made up of a couple of counselors, a couple of school board members, the manager, and the superintendent that could review the actual dollar figures to make sure that the amount was correct, that they would have time to get back to us. It would be printed and out. And there's no conspiracy here. It's a matter of trying to push things along in a timely fashion and get it taken care of for the benefit of everybody in this community. And that is all. And Marie, certainly come to the podium if you'd like.
I would just like to make one comment for clarification, and that is that the school board did not request that this be voted on tonight. That was a conversation between Jack and myself, and Jack had asked us if we had a problem with moving this up to May from July because the council would like to have this finished.
Could I read this?
The letter. We have a letter from it that says we want
to... We have a letter
to Jack Roberts and the other people on the council from Marie Prager and everyone else on the school board, and I'm really confused. It's April 30th, 2003, regarding Pond Cove addition and high school renovation project. Please be advised that the school board formally reaffirmed the following recommendations at their April 29th, 2003 special meeting regarding the proposed building projects. And it says, well, it is our understanding that the town council has received the complete summary report issued by HKTA, that's the architectural firm, and that an agreement has been reached by Councilors Lynch and Swift Kayada to accept the enrollment projections, the best fit model, as presented to the town council at the March 12, 2003 public hearing. Recommendations are as follows. One, the school board requests that the town council approve at their May 12, 2003 meeting the expenditure of an amount not to exceed $1,475,648 for the building addition to Pond Cove School. Two, the school board also requests approval for a referendum in the spring of 2004 for the high school renovation project at a cost not to exceed $7,530,758 as has been previously presented to the council. If the Pond Cove project is not approved on May 12th, it will be necessary to lease portable classrooms in the fall of 2004. Thank you for your consideration of our request. So this is item number one. Well, this is item number 123 through 125. So, yeah,
but the key is that they recommended at our May 12th meeting.
Yeah, yeah, and that is true.
Okay.
And that
that's all I said.
The request from Jack to me, if it would be okay to have this decision made at the May 12th meeting, because all of the information had been submitted that you had asked for in March, and the town council did not want to wait until July to make the decision. And yep. I had said yes. All I'm saying is the request did not come from me. Okay. The request came from Jack.
It's kind of middle ground. We're saying the same thing, but slightly different. What I had asked or suggested, I was going to put the two out for referendum. The school board came back and asked that we vote on it again tonight. Is that...
You know, I don't mind. We can put it off till July if there's any feeling of a conspiracy. I mean, I have to say I'm getting a little frustrated. I don't think it will change the result.
No.
I, for one, assuming I'm on the prevailing side tonight, would be glad to move for reconsideration in July if that's necessary. Or we can defer the whole thing to July. But I'm a little angry at the suggestion that there's a conspiracy here. I'm glad to vote on it tonight.
Yeah.
But I'm glad to wait till July. I'm glad to ask for reconsideration in July. But I frankly thought that people wanted to get a kindergarten built and wanted to get moving on the project. It does us no good to talk about conspiracies. So... I had to say, and I was on the building committee, and I'm getting very frustrated.
Councilor Carson.
I have no vote at all. I'm more than happy to wait till July. It makes it great for me.
We'll go home and we'll...
I really felt when we talked about this at that other meeting, I can remember saying, well, we'll do it. We talked about even doing it late, and I said, well, okay, let's do it in July. We just kept trying to move it up. I think we were trying to be cooperative. But if the school people are more comfortable with voting in July, I don't think there's any counselors up here that it was, we thought we were doing the right thing by moving it along faster. You want us to wait till July?
That's all I was trying to do, is move it forward.
If I could comment, it is my belief that the town council was ready in February to vote on this, to send it to a fall referendum. To a spring referendum.
That's right.
It was ready in February. It was on our agenda in February at the school board's request to approve a spring, that is May 2003, referendum, in which case it would have been voted on last week and it'd all be settled by now. But Ms. Prager, as chairman of the school board, got up and asked us to defer and not have a spring referendum, but indeed to have a fall referendum. And if I could Well, never mind. It's pointless. We were ready in February. We were ready in March. It was the school board's request to put it off for a fall referendum. I'm ready now to vote on it. I don't care if you know, I thought the school board, as I just read this letter, I thought the school board wanted us to vote on it in May.
Right.
But, you know, if the common feeling, I don't know if this, since the school board, I think we sort of...
I'd just like to...
There's been a request from the school board, so I don't know if we even have a motion at this point to deal with it, but...
We don't have a motion.
There's
no motion. I would like to just, it's not a public hearing, it's not a debate, but I'd like to ask the chairwoman of the school board to clarify whether the school board wants on its own to have a vote tonight or would prefer to have a vote in July.
School.
Marie, please.
Again, I will say, Jack asked me if we could get this over with in May and the school board obliged. And all I would like is for the town council to vote on the addition to Pine Cove, yes or no, tonight. And whatever that decision will be brought back to the school board in full. And that has been my request all along.
Thank you. Do we have
We should see if there's a motion.
I was just asking. Is there's a session. Do I have a counselor prepared to move the authorizing the addition to the Pond Cove School? No motion? Okay. Do I have a motion then to table indefinitely?
Well, seeing no motion, I would move indefinite postponement of item.
Or to July or?
I'm moving indefinite postponement of item 123.
All right. Do I hear a second? Do we have a second?
I'm not clear on what's happening. There was no motion.
If there's no action on that, we'd at least need a motion.
Didn't the item fail for lack of a motion?
Fails for lack of a motion.
Okay, then I withdraw my motion if we can go on to the next item on the agenda.
I guess I'd ask Mike.
If you don't need a motion to dispose of it, I'll withdraw my
motion.
Can it come back if there's no action on it?
Well, there is no motion.
You know.
But
item fail?
Quick, no.
If I might, I don't have Robert's Rules of Order in front of me, but generally, if there's an item on an agenda that's duly placed on the agenda, there is a necessity to remove that item from the agenda, or to table the item indefinitely, or to take some other action on it.
Then I will move indefinite postponement of item 123.
Second.
Right. Any further discussion? All in favor? Vote to be unanimous. Item number 124-0102, draft vote authorizing Pond Cove School addition after a referendum. Do I hear him? Is there a counselor prepared to make a motion?
I'm sorry.
Counselor Swift-Cayetta.
I would like to move item 124, a draft vote authorizing Pond Cove School addition after a referendum vote. Basically, it sends the issue to the people.
And that would be?
For a fall referendum.
For fall.
Fall 2003 referendum.
And do you want to specify the dollar amount, Counselor?
$1.475 million.
Not to exceed.
All right. And the second.
It says drafted. There's a lot of verbiage that goes with it legally for the purposes of the referendum election. So I would propose it as drafted under item 124 on our agenda.
All right. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion from council?
Do we have any idea what that means in real dollars? I mean, it's $1.4 million, but
yes,
based on today's interest rate, do we know how much that's going to cost the town?
$2.8 million.
$2.8?
I'm sorry, that also includes operating costs, so Mike would be able to give us more.
The bonding cost itself for principal and interest would be somewhat around $2 million, $2.1 million, depending on the interest rates in place at the time.
All right. Any further discussion?
Yeah.
Councilor Swift-Gayetta.
I would like to speak on this issue as the person who made the motion. Three basic points guide my views on the kindergarten issue. First, and I would like to explain my position as several people have asked. First, if enrollment were reasonably projected to rise significantly in the long term, I would support the proposed addition. Second, enrollment is not projected to rise long term. On the contrary, the school board's own study shows that it is projected to fall. On behalf of the council, I, along with Councilor Lynch, met with Planning Decisions, the consulting firm that did the enrollment projections, and also along with the school board representatives. At that meeting, all of us agreed that the best, that is, most likely projection is that in just over 3 years, there will be fewer Cape Elizabeth System students than the current population of 1,779. And moreover, that enrollment will drop even more thereafter, declining to 1,677 by 2012. That's a decrease of 102 students from today. I encourage everyone, please, to review the actual agreed upon best fit numbers from the March 2003 planning decision study, which is available at the Thomas Memorial Library. Third, I nevertheless remain willing to put the issue out to public referendum, even though I'm not personally convinced. Back in February, the council was ready to do this so that there would be a vote this month at last week's election. The school board and the superintendent declined to go forward with a May referendum, saying that they would prefer to have citizens vote not in the spring, but in the fall of 2003 because they felt, quote, we cannot adequately inform the public between the time the council vote is taken and the beginning of May, unquote. And for the man in the back who's shaking his head, I encourage you to watch the tapes, please. But I have reviewed all the tapes to be sure of my facts, so that's a direct quote. Let me say a bit more about the numbers. I have gotten some calls and some emails from some people who, in good faith, have gotten the impression that there is a long-term space shortage in the schools. That is simply not the case. They appear to be confused by two things. First, during her March presentation on the new school population numbers, the school board chair analyzed classroom space needs in part using larger enrollment numbers than those in the best fit or most likely model. This, by the way, was not the chair's fault. Planning Decision based their so-called high model numbers on a history of housing permit applications, including ones that were later pulled, sent back, rather than on actual housing starts in Cape Elizabeth. That mistake skewed their estimates significantly. After meeting jointly with Planning Decisions, the board and the council have now agreed that those higher model numbers should not be used for planning purposes since they were based on unlikely assumptions. Secondly, there is the issue of what is sometimes called program integrity, having all of K through 4 in the same four walls at all times. The total school population is not evenly divided amongst all the grades. There will be times when, for example, there will be too few rooms in the K through 4 part of the Pond Cove Middle School complex to house all K through 4 regular classes and their special functions like art and music. However, at the same time, there will be empty space in the middle school as their enrollment declines. The school board proposal is to have the middle school space stay empty and to build more permanent K through 4 space. I think it would be more prudent to simply use some of the available middle school rooms for K through 4 music, art, occupational therapy, or other special educational functions, not regular classrooms, as needed. Every dollar spent on bricks and mortar is a dollar less available to spend on teachers and programs. And we know that we are going to have to spend money on renovating the high school, which sorely needs repairs. I cannot support putting teachers or programs on a diet for 20 years to build space that we can obtain for the short term at one-tenth the cost. $2.8 million for an addition, which includes all the interest payments, increased operational costs, and so on, based on numbers the school board provided, versus under $200,000 for two portables for a few years and then using current space flexibly. As for portables, they are not a great long-term solution, but they work fine for the short term, which is what we need them for. My younger daughter spent third grade at Pond Cove in a portable, which she thought was sort of cool, sort of an adventure. That year was one of her best in school because she had a wonderful teacher, Ogden Williams. I have never heard anyone reminisce about their school days saying what a great building they occupied. Rather, people talk about fond memories of a wonderful program they were in or a fabulous teacher who helped or inspired them. In my mind, those factors, teachers and programs, are much more important to education than bricks and mortar. Faculty and programs are more important places to put our money. We need to move forward tonight. The public has been waiting long enough. The best thing to do, given the public importance of this issue and the number of people so interested and with varying opinions, is to set this question for a fall 2003 referendum so that everyone can be heard and can use their votes to decide the issue. I trust the people of Cape Elizabeth to make the right choice for our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other councilors wish to speak? Councilor Lynch.
I have just a few comments to make. Just want to address some of the questions that were raised. I think the kindergarten is a close call. We did meet with Marie and Marie Prager, the chairwoman of the school board, and we looked at those numbers. For me, the conclusion I came to is that the Pond Cove building will continue to be fully occupied through 2010. But there is, or should be, based on the school board's own numbers, some space somewhere in the building. But again, I'm concerned that Pond Cove does appear to be fully occupied. For me, it does come down to the question of the population projections being so close one way or another, added to a difficult economic situation. I just read a front page article in today's New York Times that stated that New York and Maine are tied for first place in combined state and local tax burdens. So I'm mindful that what we do here contributes to that notorious first place. On April 26th, the New York Times reported that for the first time since the 1980s, the average pay of workers at all levels fell in real terms. Our unemployment rate is currently at 6%, and our revaluation has led to 56% of the town residents paying higher taxes. So I think it's a close call. There is a need for space at Pond Cove, but there may be space at the middle school. My own son traveled from Pond Cove to the middle school for OT. So, you know, it's not ideal. I'd love for it to be ideal, but I think in this kind of climate, we'll be well served by the collective wisdom of the voters. In fact, I had an email this weekend from someone suggesting that the town council was only listening to one segment of the population. And I guess I can't help but think that that the town seems so divided on this that a referendum is the best way to find out what the majority thinks. I was on the pool building committee, which I think was, 5 years ago, Michael? I was not on the town council then, but I was on the pool building committee. It was another controversial project. It didn't pass by much. Help me out again, Michael. 100 votes?
The pool?
More than that. But people...
But it was on the... We put it on
it,
the
It
ballot.
Was on the ballot.
The ballot.
And once it passed, there was never another word of complaint. I was not on the council for the police, the fire, and the public works. I do not agree, and I have philosophical objection to a system where the council can place some things on the ballot and other things not. But I told school building supporters and opponents alike that while I believe we need a charter change, I think we need to address that separately. And I was clear with people who were opposing the school project as well as those supporting them in February that I was prepared to vote to put this project out to referendum. So in this case, I will follow the tradition of school projects going out to referendum. I think it's a much closer call than my fellow councilor, Swift Kayada. But I respect the collective judgment of the voters of Cape Elizabeth. And I've lived in this town 19 years, and I, with the possible exception of losing Henry, I have yet to be disappointed in the voters. So I think it's time to start working on it, and again, I look forward to the campaign.
Any further, Councilor Fritz?
I think it's really important that in a town our size, we use our space as efficiently as we possibly can. And I think that having the kindergarten in for the past 10 years in the high school was a very wise use of space. And now that space is needed for the high school. So I definitely favor bringing the kindergarten to Pond Cove. But with the enrollment numbers that we have for the long term, unless they say we positively are moving toward increased enrollment, I don't see that it makes any sense to build a wing and do construction. I don't think portable classrooms have to be a bad situation. I've heard that they are small, but I think we can be flexible and not have kids in them all day long. I'm disappointed at the way the 1930s building has been used. We had the impression that when we moved community services out of the 1930s building, there could be four classrooms there. And I don't see that it has been used that way. So I think there's a lot of flexibility that could be done at Pond Cove and the middle school. I personally don't think that the kindergarten wing is a necessary addition, but I also think that it's a controversial issue and should go out to referendum in the fall.
Thank you. Any further discussion from council? Councilor Barry?
I've said that all along. I think that the democratic process is best served by having the greatest number of people possible make the decision.
Thank you. Nope. And he doesn't weigh in. All right.
I had several long comments, but I am not going to make
them. All right. I would only add that a number of the emails that I had received were related to kindergarten students being placed into portables. That would be a school department decision, obviously, but there is no reason that I can see why, if portables were needed, if the school department did not have the flexibility just to use existing space, that the portable certainly could be used to house the music, the art, the programs that the kids are not in them all day long, and the kindergarten children would be in Pond Cove building itself. And like Councilor Swift Kayada, my son spent fifth grade in the portables, and for several months I was asking if we could go visit one because I'd never seen one. My wife reminded me that Mark was in the portable for an entire year, so. And I went there to all the parent-teacher conferences and wasn't even aware that I was in a portable, so it was attached to the building. So even if the children were put into the portable, I'm not sure what people's impression of them are, particularly if they're connected to the building. They're not bad structures. But again, that would be a school department decision, and my recommendation to them would be put the art, the music, those programs where the kids are only there for two or three classes a week and utilize it that way if the parents are truly concerned about it, but they don't need to be. With that, if there's no further discussion from council, I would ask to move the question. All in favor of putting the, this item to referendum in November of 2003. Show it to be unanimous. Item number 125-0203, a draft vote has been presented authorizing the high school project after a referendum. I had commented that on that a little bit earlier, that we have the material. It has been a while since these numbers have been really looked at. Should the council vote to send this out to referendum, my preference would be without a dollar figure, and that we would put together a subcommittee, a finance committee, if you will, of the school and the town, with the as voting members, either two or three each, and the superintendent and the town manager to come back to the council at an early date with the figure that we would put on the ballot. And I would also recommend that the two new councilors and the new school board member be at least party to that committee. So I know at least two of them are sitting here, so hopefully they would be willing to do that. With that, I would ask if there's a motion.
A motion. I would like to also speak to my motion.
Okay, certainly.
I move to submit the question of the high school renovation project, in particular incurring expenditures and issuing bonds, to the voters of the town of Cape Elizabeth in a referendum election to be held on November 4th, 2003. I further move that the exact amount of such referendum question be referred to a special subcommittee of the council to include three council members and three school board members to be appointed by the chairman of the council, which should meet as necessary to review the project and report back to the full council at a workshop no later than July 10th, so that the council can fix a final number at its regular meeting July 14th. And I have this motion in writing so that the clerk need not. And now if I may just speak to it. I did serve on...
Second first.
I'm sorry.
Do we have a second to the motion?
Second.
Now the discussion will start with Councilor Lynch.
I served on the building committee, and I'm fully convinced that much of the work of the high school must be done, and must be done sooner rather than later. However, I recognize that the full council has only recently received the building report on April 10th, containing the details of the $7.5 million project. And we have spent the last month working on the municipal budget for FY 2004, so we have been unable to turn our attention as a council up to this point on the high school project. This motion, I believe, would put us, first of all, on record in support of the high school renovation referendum in November. Second, it would put our deliberations of this project on a fast track. Whoever serves on the subcommittee would need to meet with the architects and the school and whoever else would be involved in the next couple of months. But I'm fearful that if we don't do it this way, the summer will come and it will become impossible to resolve this issue. So it just struck me that this would allow time for subcommittee. The architects and the school board has done their work. Anyone on the council could attend the subcommittee meetings besides the subcommittee members. And then in July 10th, the subcommittee can either come back ratifying the $7.5 million project or propose a different number, or perhaps I would even offer a staging plan. And by that I mean, this is not a typical building project. We've got 500 kids in a building that we're proposing to spend $7.5 million to renovate. Those children aren't going away. We will necessarily have to work on the project probably over summers and by wings. So it strikes me that there is an opportunity to stage the work over a period of 1 or 2 or 3 years so that we are as least disruptive as possible to the children and the learning that's going on. And second, can sort of feather this into our tax base, because we know we can't spend $7.5 million in a year with 500 kids in the building. It's just not going to realistically happen. So I think if we have a committee look at this, if they're committed to work hard on this for the next month or two, we can get this done in July, and then it gives everyone time to work on the educating the public in time for a November election.
Thank you. Further discussion? Councilor Fritz.
I think this is a good idea to examine the high school much more closely. I mean, I know the high school needs renovation, but I'm concerned about the debt that we have, how it's structured, whether we need all the things that are proposed, whether they can be staged from inside to outside at different times, different parts of the building, I think. So I think it's really important that we have this committee that examines the issues much more closely than we've had the opportunity to do.
Further comments? Either side? And I would just add that I, of course, see this committee also determining how the whole project would be administered, what would be done, and when it would be done. That was part of my thinking going into putting together this type of a committee. John, do you have a question or a comment?
I mean, when we talked to the school board previously, I mean, they already have a site plan approval for, like, portables. They already plan to do that in stages, put some of the kids in portables. Don't they have site plan approval for portables at the high school? I think we went through that, right? And I see some, yes, I think that's
at the high school. All right.
So they'd already planned to kind of phase that and do that, as I recall.
Right. A lot of it's in that plan. Making sure everybody's
on the same
page.
We're just kind of talking about the dollars now, right?
I'm talking about the dollars.
Okay.
And how
the
stream of revenue to support the construction project. You may not need to borrow all $7.5 million right away.
Yeah, okay.
We're not going to redo what the committee's work was.
Right, okay.
It's more a financial
issue.
Trying
to figure out the dollar.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And we can explain to the public then how much it will cost when.
Just a clarification. My understanding is that the site plan approval for portables that was approved by the planning board last year was not related to a building construction project. It was relating to the feeling there was a need for portables at that point in time, which then there was some reshuffling, so that the portables that might be necessary during the construction project might not be the same portable plan as went to the planning board a year ago. That I think we're looking at two different things.
Tom, would the superintendent, Dr. Fusella, give us his insight on that one?
If the referendum passes in November, the portables would be placed at the high school because, as you said, we phase in the renovation, and we could keep the kindergarten where it is until, if the referendum passes and the new space is created, then move the kindergarten over. We would still need the portables. We need the extra space. And then that space could be used once the kindergarten leaves as swing space as we're in the renovation, because as Marianne has said, that we could be renovating a portion of the building and we'll need that extra space. That was the original plan.
If I might through you, Mr. Chairman. So it's the same numbers of portables and the same plan that was approved a year ago?
Yes, it is. And now, if the referendum fails, though, the plan would be to place the portables at Pond Cove, because that's where that space would be needed, since we're not doing any work or not anticipating any, it would be a different plan. Right.
Thank you.
I just want to be real clear. The words of my motion were to submit the question to the voters, leaving only the dollar figure blank. So this puts this council on record in support of the high school renovation project.
No, put it to referendum and go.
Yeah, I'm sorry, on record to put it to referendum.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. My only question is, can we do that without a number figure? That's the only
We've set ourselves a challenging schedule to to come up with a figure.
I might add, the town manager, I spoke with Michael earlier, he is comfortable with that figure that is in there. And if people are more comfortable leaving that number there, the committee could, if it saw it necessary, perhaps we could come back to readdress that. Is that the way we would do it, Mike?
Yeah.
Jack, excuse me.
Yeah,
the committee can come back with that figure. The idea is that because we've spent the last month working on our budget, we haven't looked at this. So this is a way to just fast-track what we would normally do over maybe a more leisurely pace. But this committee could come back, maybe will come back with $7.5 million, could come back with $6.5 million,
could come back
with $8 million. So...
Mike? Did you have a question? You addressed the question to me.
I had mentioned that you were comfortable with these figures, and if other councilors want a figure plugged in, that I agree with Councilor Lynch.
I am comfortable with supporting Councilor Lynch's motion. I think it's well thought out. I support a renovation of the high school. I think it needs work, some significant work. I am a person who's perhaps obsessive about the facts and the numbers, but I have not had, but I have not had an opportunity to closely examine the $7.5 million number, yet I think we need to move forward. The high school's not getting any
younger,
better, and or any younger. So I support Councilor Lynch's recommendation to set this for fall referendum, and leave the number blank for the moment, but the committee will come back with a number that they feel is appropriate. It's a joint committee of the councilors. Well, I'm sorry, it's a town council committee, but it's got three councilors and three school board members on it, and it's got the superintendent and the town manager as ex officio members, and they will come back and provide a consensus number to us, and the council will decide what number to put on the ballot. I think you said mid-July, which would give us enough time to get it on the ballot, to have plenty of time for full review, educational process in the community so that people could figure out whether they support it or didn't support it. And I hope they support it because it needs to be done.
Chairman?
Councilor Barry?
You're talking about a number that's a cap.
No.
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 Could go higher. Maybe the committee will meet and find out they want to spend more.
These figures were put together... A year and a half ago now, perhaps, yeah. Or not quite that far back?
About 6 months ago, maybe.
When would, approximately how long ago?
Before it was only finalized.
That the number was last looked at or tweaked?
Probably 6 to 8 months.
6 to 8 months ago. I'll repeat that for the camera. All right. So the figures are relatively new. But
it's also my understanding that the council could say it's a different number than what the committee comes back with.
Yes, yes. The committee, as I understand it, would come back, make a recommendation to the full council, and the council would then decide what the number was.
Which number to plug in.
Which number to plug in.
And it could be lower, it could be higher. If they feel
the subcommittee is really just a method of jump-starting moving it quickly, with having to only schedule meetings around three counselors and three school board members instead of seven counselors' schedules, just a way to jumpstart it, get it moving, and hopefully line it all up for November.
Councilor Barry.
If this number is not a cap, what is it?
She has no number in her motion.
No, I know that. But when you come up with a cap, when you come up with a number, what is the number? Is that a cap?
That number, after review, would be the cap that was going out to referendum.
That's my question. It is a cap.
And when it goes out to referendum, it's necessarily a cap because that's what people have voted it.
That's what I want to make sure.
Okay.
Cape Elizabeth.
Councilor McGinty.
I'm going to support this motion. I just want to make a comment that Kevin, I didn't catch his last name. I think he left already. He spoke. Talked about the fire station, police station, and he was absolutely positively correct. We didn't even have a public hearing on expenditure of that money. And over my objection, I might add, because I wanted to have a public hearing, we didn't have a public hearing. He was absolutely positively correct. We didn't have a public hearing on expenditure for the fire station and the police station, and he was right. And again, over my objection at the time, I might add, I'm not even sure who was on the town council at that time, but he was correct.
I just want to say I'm a seconder on this motion, and I completely support the renovations to the high school, and I probably would have been able to vote for those 6 or 8 months ago. So I'd like to move the question.
Very good.
Could I, before that happens, could I make a brief comment?
Certainly. Go ahead, Mike.
Yeah. I keep hearing that these municipal projects were somehow approved under the cover of darkness. nothing could be further than the truth.
Thank you.
It was on the front page of the Cape Courier time after time. It was on the web page. It was very closely advertised. Most of the folks I hear this from, and say that it suddenly came out of the blue, that, it had been proposed variations of the project beginning in 1983.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
It wasn't something that just came out of the blue. It was put off two or three different times. The first major time it was put off was to accomplish the elementary and middle school addition of $11.2 million that ended up coming out, I think it was $11.7 million. So because the school's needs were put first, the police and fire needs were put off. The record couldn't be any clearer than that. There was another municipal facilities committee that all of its reports were widely covered in the newspapers, in both the Press Herald as well as the Cape Courier. We didn't have all these other community newspapers then. It was all fully exposed, again, on the front pages of those newspapers. And then what happened, suddenly the pool came up. And the council decided the pool was perhaps dangerous, falling apart, and we're going to put that first. So it was delayed again. Again, there were public meetings. There were notices sent out to citizens. Maybe there wasn't a formal public hearing, but it wasn't at all unlike this evening when, folks were given comments, opportunities to comment. And I find it a little bit frustrating that in trying to advance some other project, we keep need to revisit these other projects, which are doing a tremendous job, I think, serving the community, in which the public had every opportunity to comment on. And, I have fully supported these school projects. Everyone on the municipal side of government, to my knowledge, has worked for these school projects. And I don't know why we need to keep criticizing the municipal projects. I think they're excellent projects. They were strongly supported by the councils at the time, nearly unanimous on every single project. I think, John, you were the only one that voted against it once. And the citizens who came forward, we had a police station. For those of you that didn't live in town at the time, we had a police station. There was one room. There was a locker room for men and women. That was the lunch room. That was a conference room. That was the library. That was the gun storage room. I know we don't have a lot of knowledge of history in this community, yes, but those are the facts. I'm sorry to get up on my soapbox on this, but I keep hearing this over and over in reading the emails, and I'm tempted to respond to all the emails. I don't usually, but, the municipal projects were good projects. They're serving the community well, and when we look, I recently looked at the tax rate that the town is spending for debt service, and we hear about all the problems with the town taking on this debt. In the year 2000, the municipal tax rate for debt service was $1.47. If you look at the proposed budget, you look at for debt service for fiscal year 2004, based on the old values, it's $1.46. Because of the use of the debt stabilization fund, because of long-term advance planning on those projects, we're actually spending less for debt service than before we built that terrible public works garage, the terrible police station, that terrible fire station, and we bought the community service project, and which actually I'm being a little bit facetious now. But I wish we'd be proud of these buildings and wish everyone would be as proud of them as I am. I know not everyone can be, but I just get tired of, just because people don't like a few stone walls of $40,000 that we keep dumping on these projects. And I'm getting a little bit tired of it, and I've had my say now, and I appreciate you not moving the question.
I was going to move the question only because I know that the town manager has to drive some god-awful
business. I do. That's okay. I had to say that.
I appreciate
early in the morning, so let's move the question.
All in favor of the motion as presented? Show it to be unanimous. And I'd almost like to give you a round of applause for that. Yeah. I really appreciate it.
Well, anyway, you know, I was not criticizing, you know.
No, but, John.
You know, I appreciate it. I worked there at that building, and I'm on the fire department now, and I appreciate the new building, as all the new firefighters do. And so, obviously, but I think yeah, he was.
Item number 12602. Shouldn't that be 0203?
Yeah, it should be.
Set public hearing on eliminating town council $350 annual pay.
I so move.
Second. Do our new councilors wish to weigh in on this one? any discussion? Seeing none.
I wonder if any of the new councilors are commenting about eliminating the
pay. They realize that they now are not going to get paid the $350. Sorry, guys.
We're just setting this public hearing.
We're actually going to set a public hearing, so we have a motion to set the public hearing.
You did.
On June 9th.
Second.
That was seconded. All in favor? Item number 127-0203. We received a Fort Williams master plan. I unfortunately, personally, did not have an awful lot of time to look at it and peruse it, but as you can see, it is an excellent piece of work, and I would like to have a motion to refer this to a joint workshop, if we could, of both the council and the planning board. And the reason I'd like to have it as a joint workshop, it would save those consultant fees on one time, so there'd be a little fiscal austerity there. So do we have a motion to accept and refer?
I would like to move that we acknowledge receipt of the draft update to the Fort Williams Park Master Plan with appreciation to Fort Williams Advisory Commission and to land use consultants, and that we refer this draft to the planning board and a future town council workshop meeting.
Second.
For review.
And we had a second. Any discussion? All right. And I would like to also echo Councilor Swift Kayada's comments, and thank you to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. They have done an excellent job on this, I'm sure. Just I only briefly scanned it, but all in favor? Thank you very much. Item 129-0203, abatement request.
128.
I skip one again. Can't blame the glasses on that one, I guess. Item 128-0203, Fort Williams Park uses. And we'll need a motion to approve the Fort Williams Advisory Commission's recommendation for three uses of the fort. So if somebody would be willing to make that motion for me.
So move.
And second?
Second.
All right, now I'll identify them as the U.S. Coast Guard Change of Command Ceremony, June 26, 2003, the Maine Army National Guard, June 28, 2003, and the National Association of Secretaries of State, July 27, 03. Any discussion? All in favor? So that can be unanimous. Item 129-0203, abatement request. We have a motion before us to abate personal property taxes for the recommendation of the Assistant Town Manager and the Assessor, Capital Associates International, $247.38. Sheer Madness, $19.86. Both businesses have moved, and the Assessor and the Tax Collector have determined that they are uncollectible. I would entertain a motion to approve the abatement.
So moved.
Second.
Where was Capital Associates International?
Deborah, do you know the answer to that? Yeah, why don't you go to the podium, please? Thank you.
Just real quick, the name doesn't ring a bell.
It was actually for rental equipment. Sometimes businesses have to rent, like Gecko Brothers does the ice boxes outside of you, buy ice at Cumberland Farms and so forth. This is probably like computer equipment or something.
Leased equipment.
That they're no longer,
I didn't recognize the name either. Okay, thank you. Any further discussion by council? All in favor of the abatement request from the assessor and tax collector? And I believe you can show that to be unanimous. We're back now to the citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. If someone would like to step forward and speak to that, please state your name and address for the record.
Hi, I'm Sue Pierce, and I live at 59 Hunts Point Road. And this item isn't on the agenda, but I've been involved now for the past few years on the building project. And one thing that I'm concerned about is, well, two things. One is the process of moving projects forward. There's no written process. It seems like there's a lot of confusion, a lot of time is wasted by people on committees. There's confusion about whether public hearings are needed, what the process is. There was discussion time and time again. I think for all future projects, if it's changing a charter or any building project in town, there should be a written document that is given to a committee that they are not wasting time and they understand what the steps need to be taken. And I think then we will avoid a lot of the back and forth, he said, she said. I also have a request for the council, as well as our other elected bodies, the school board, is that I think we are at a time that these two elected bodies need to work together. And as a citizen, I'm very frustrated to see that we have elected officials that, you know, I think the idea of a high school committee, although it's frustrating, and this might be talking on gender, frustrating because I feel like it's a step back after the committee did 3 years of work. At least it says that the school board and the town council will work together. And I think that's very important. We're one town. We're not school parents. We're not fixed income. I think we all have the same, you know, same goals for the town. And I just request that our elected bodies work together. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. Anyone else would like to speak to the council? Prior to adjourning, then, I would like just to mention, Penny,
I just wanted to take
Carson.
Yeah, I just wanted to take a few moments, if I could, to comment on, since it being my last council meeting and you're all sort of, an audience is sitting out there, I get to speak to you, I guess. I was interested to see at the recent candidates night that nobody spoke about the comprehensive plan, which is the vision for our community. And I don't even know if anybody requested them to get them, but nobody ever talked about it. And nobody ever mentioned the usual phrase that always happens when people sit up here for candidates night is, I really want to protect the character of our town. I can't remember a year when I have either been involved or watched a candidates night when some candidate has not said, I really want to protect the character of our town. Something has happened in the last 2 or 3 years where that focus has certainly changed. I looked up in the dictionary the word character, and it said, the combination of qualities or features that distinguishes one person, group, or place from another. And I've been thinking about mentioning some of the things that stand out in my mind, although in my later years, my memory is not as good, so there may be some things I'll certainly forget. But I wanted to talk about some of these things in the 14 years, like the new playgrounds, new basketball courts for the children, 5 new sports playing fields for the children, $11 million in elementary school improvements, almost $3 million for the pool and fitness improvements, the new children's library and the preservation of the library's 2 historic buildings, the new community service building, which is a preservation of an historic building in our community, the continued work we do in the town hall, which is an historic building in our community, the creation of the town center, which is where these buildings are, a wonderful celebration that we had when Joni won the Olympic gold medal. We've saved and protected for future generations lots of open space, green belts. We've created the town center plan. And as mentioned in my little proclamation, the Goddard Mansion, where 100 seventh and eighth grade students came out and worked to save that building. So I thought about those things, and you say, well, the Goddard Mansion, what is the big deal? You've got this ruin over there on the rock over there, so what is it? But it is part of the character. It is not just schools, it's not just municipal buildings, it's all of these things together that make the character. And I'm happy and pleased with myself that I supported these things and that I have remembered a few of them. But what do they mean? They're not buildings, but still they're monuments to the character of the town. I was born here and my parents moved here. They moved here because of the character of the town. And then all of those people that have participated in these last few years, and especially in the school, they have to look about why did they move here to Cape Elizabeth. They moved here because of the schools, for one thing, but it isn't just the schools. In the last 10 or 15 years, we've had an enormous increase of people who've moved to Cape Elizabeth who have no children or whose children are grown. And they moved here for a reason. They moved here for the character, whatever the character is. Why is that that they've moved here? If they don't need the schools, they've moved here for something else. The definition says that that character sets us apart, that it distinguishes us from others. And it is those intangible things that need to be protected. I'm asking the next town councils and the citizens to look out for the town's character, to protect us from being just another community. Or for all those newer people that have moved to town, not make us into whatever town they left in Massachusetts or Connecticut or whatever it was, but to keep us for what we are, to protect us for Cape Elizabeth. I just did want to say that I am honored and I am pleased and I have served with pleasure serving on this town council and on many, many subcommittees. And I hope and I urge new councilors, future councilors, and citizens to try and protect, which I said to one of my friends and she commented on it, I want you to look out for my little town by the sea. And I appreciate the time that I've had here, and I appreciate your support. I just wanted to make a few comments in my last meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And when your parents moved here, they brought us quite a character. And I hope I hope you never change either. Thank you, Penny, and thank you, Henry.
One more thing.
Sure.
Just very briefly, I just want to say how much I've enjoyed working with Henry the last 6 years. It's been a real pleasure, and you know, he's always been the anchor over there. As I would look on the left, some would look on the right, and I think he would prefer on the right, but we shall see. And over on the other side, it strikes me that it's a historic moment.
My chair.
That particular seat, except when they were serving as council chair,
right,
has been held by William H. Jordan or by Penelope P. Carson.
That's right.
In various forms since 1961.
Oh, wow.
Either Billy or Penny have been on the council, so.
Well, we wouldn't give it up. When each of us transferred positions, we always
have to trade it, so I can't wait to see who the council decides to sit
in
next one, so enjoy it.
If they're not fighting over my chair, I'll feel real bad, sadly.
Anyone else have some comments here?
David.
I'd just like to say that I appreciate very much the wise counsel that both Penny and Henry have given me in my short 4 years on the council. And while we have not always agreed on every issue, it's been very illuminating. I've learned a lot from you, and I appreciate the help you've given me, and I applaud the service that you have given to the town so selflessly for that big $350 a year, which is now gone, now about to be gone. Thank you.
Citizens may come forward and tell us they want us to double it.
No.
Councilor Lynch.
I knew it would be late, so I wrote mine down, and there were a few things I didn't want to forget. And Henry, I just want to say, in my view, you are the heart of this council. I first met you at the dump when I was campaigning. I'm not sure you voted for me then.
I did.
You don't have to say, but but you were gracious, you were encouraging, and you were kind on a cold day in April. And for that, I thank you. And you've continued to be gracious, kind, and encouraging. Since then, I've seen you play the piano at a town council meeting. And everyone knows how important music is to the quality of our lives. And most importantly, and always, I've seen you fight for the little guy and the taxpayer, especially in your service on the Thomas Jordan Trust Committee, which helps the disadvantaged. Henry, I know this is a nonpartisan body, but I've enjoyed and I've respected your brand of bleeding heart Republicanism. And I will really miss you. And Penny, you are not going to escape.
Mm-hmm.
Because Penny, I first met you in 1980 when I was I was running the congressional campaign of someone very special in your life who was running for the first district. And we had a lot of fun together. You were a young mother back then with young children. You were probably younger than I am now. But I want to thank you for your guidance on this council. You, more than anyone, have taught me what it means to be, to represent the public, to listen and to be guided by what the majority wants. I think at one time I may have thought that we were elected to do what we think is best, but from you I've learned that it's a dangerous thing to do that, and that we really are elected to do what the majority wants this town to be. And again, you have, in your discussion of the character of the town, have reflected what I think is the values of the majority of Cape Elizabeth. And I've learned from you about the importance of representative government, so I thank you, and I'm just so honored and privileged to have served with both of you.
Thank you very much. Two high schoolers. When I came, Michael was also a baby beginning.
So that's what went wrong.
No, he was really in college.
And I was out of college, but yeah, right. I like to pretend.
Gerald, I didn't prepare anything.
I didn't expect at all. We've not done this before. This is very nice.
But I am going to miss Penny and Henry, because I think we've found ourselves on the same side on a number of issues that have protected open space and you know, voted for green belts and things like that. So I'm going to have to cultivate the more votes.
New council.
In order to keep those things intact in the town. So, but I'm going to miss both of you.
I might as well.
You don't have to say
And you know, I couldn't say it more. I mean, are my articulate friends on the right side of the podium? They always say everything before. I always let Ann go before me, because she always articulates everything so well, and I just go ditto. Very easy.
Except both
Henry and Penny. I mean, they bring dedication, experience, and knowledge. All those things that, you know, you learn from. As I think, Marianne said, you know, you learn from people like that. They bring that. You go for them for counsel, and you understand that. And I mean, and Penny said it. Penny and I are probably on the total opposite ends of the political
spectrum. I'm a moderate Democrat, John.
We're on total opposite ends of the political spectrum, probably, but, and she said it, and you know, I hate to get, everybody knows that I'm the tough guy here, and I don't get real mushy real often, but when she talks about the town, and I care about the town, and there's one thing that, you know, we put everything aside, Henry and Penny, and we care about the town, and we stand shoulder to shoulder, and we joke about Goddard Mansion and all that, but we stand shoulder to shoulder about protecting the rural character of the town and the right. character of the town. And that's very important. And again, we can argue and, I mean, rigorously discuss issues, but both Henry and Penny care about this town, and as I do. And I think that's what's important, is caring about the town. And as I said, you know, we can debate the issues, and we can argue, and we can fight, and we do all that stuff, but at the end of the day, I hate using that term, at the end of the day, we stand shoulder to shoulder about this town, and that's what's important. So I will miss both of them. I'll certainly miss Henry's jokes. When we're sitting here laughing, he's always writing something down, and he gets me going, and I have a great sense of humor, and he gets me going, and that's, we're not laughing at the people or at the, he's writing stuff down. It's, anyways, I don't know.
You weren't supposed to tell.
I'm sorry.
I think they've said it all. We'll.
I move adjournment.
All right.
I second it.
Did I mention the meetings we're having yet? Did we get lost in that one?
No, you didn't mention them.
All right. And before we get out, we'll just, for the camera, the upcoming meetings we have are the informal caucus of the new town council on Thursday, May 15, at 6 p.m. Mike and David, you guys need to be there. Memorial Day Parade, council is invited to assemble at 8:45 at Fowler Road. And again, you folks would be welcome to join us on that one as well. And in the first meeting of the 2003-2004 Town Council meeting, June 9, 7:30 p.m., and it's going to be all somebody else's problem with that, we are adjourned.
I need to see Carol and Henry as appointments committee for a minute afterwards.
Oh.